What's up, everybody, and welcome to XSTEM All Access. My name is Justin Schaefer, also known as Mr. Fascinate, and I'm excited to be back as your host for this multi-day series filled with STEM inspiration. Today is the second day of exciting new XSTEM episodes brought to you by the USA Science and Engineering Festival. The mission of the USA Science and Engineering Festival is to inspire the next generation to pursue careers in STEM. You can check out their other free programs and events for teachers and students at usasciencefestival.org. Before we begin, please join me in thanking our partners at AstraZeneca, the U.S. Air Force, and the U.S. Department of Defense, DOD STEM, for making this XSTEM series possible. I hope you're ready to be inspired by an amazing group of STEM role models and maybe even motivated to follow your own STEM path. We'll be answering your previously submitted questions during the program, but don't worry, if you have more questions during the show, send them to us using the form at usasciencefestival.org, and we'll get those answers to you after the program. Before we jump in, let me tell you a little bit more about myself. So as Mr. Fascinate, I've traveled all over the world exciting young people about STEM careers. I've worked on projects like the Magic Cool Bus. I'm building a STEM education app right now, and I host what's called the STEM Success Summit to help engage more young people and teach them STEM skills and get them prepared for STEM careers. Personally, I'm aligned with the mission of the USA Science and Engineering Festival, and I'm happy to introduce you to all kinds of really cool, diverse role models. Now, let's get started. I'm coming to you all from New York City, but y'all are representing the entire globe. Today, we have attendees from Arizona, Hawaii, Connecticut, Maryland, Oregon, New Jersey, Tennessee, and Texas, just to name a few. And from outside of the U.S., y'all are from El Salvador, Canada, Jamaica, Malaysia, Germany, Turkey, and much, much more. Welcome to everybody. Wherever you're joining us from today, make sure you also show us how you STEM on social media. Tag at USA Science Fest or me at Mr. Fascinate and use the hashtag show us how you STEM. You can share your science projects, show how you explore nature, or how you're acting as an ambassador to our planet, or anything else that's in our STEM world. Why don't we go ahead and take a virtual selfie right now so you can show me how you're STEMming today. Get your phones ready and get those cameras out because we're going to snap a little shot here. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1. I give a goofy pose too. All right, make sure you all tag USA Science Festival and me at Mr. Fascinate. And don't forget to use that hashtag, show us how you STEM. Now, let's get started with today's program. Our theme today is exploring our minds, and we're going to meet two amazing individuals who have dedicated their lives to learning more about our brains and how they can help those struggling with mental illness. First, we'll hear from Dr. Kauf Jaraza, a psychiatrist, neuroscientist, and professor from Duke University. Later in the program, we'll hear from Dr. Kay Tai, a neuroscientist and professor from the Salk Institute for Biological Studies. In between, we have two special guest appearances by the director of the National Institutes of Health, Dr. Francis Collins, and the chief medical officer of pharmaceutical company AstraZeneca, Dr. Ann Taylor. Speaking of our special guests, we're going to hear from one of them right now to kick off today's program. AstraZeneca is a global science-led biopharmaceutical business with innovative medicines used by millions of patients worldwide. In her role as chief medical officer, our first guest, Dr. Ann Taylor, leads patient safety and quality assurance teams for the company's portfolio of medicines. Dr. Taylor will be joined by AstraZeneca's Director of R&D Science Engagement, Dr. Joe Sanchez. Please welcome Dr. Ann Taylor and Dr. Joe Sanchez.
Welcome to XSTEM All Access. I'm Dr. Ann Taylor, the Chief Medical Officer at AstraZeneca, and I am so excited to be welcoming you today. I think you'll have a great time. I want to give you three messages. One, science is really fun. It's a great job. Two, any of you can be a scientist. And three, we want you to be scientists. One of the reasons that science is so fun is that there's so many different ways to be a scientist. You could work with animals. You could work with geography and geology. You could work with math, and you could work with biology and be a doctor or a lab scientist. And because of that, almost anyone can find a role in science. There's different kinds of ways that you can participate in the scientific endeavor. Why can you do it? Because everybody can do it. You need to study, but it's an accessible career with so many different ways to exist in science that everybody can find a place. And third, we need you. We need new thinking. We need young people with new ideas. We need people who bring diversity and different ways of thinking to the field, and we would love to have you join us.
Thank you for that inspiring message, Dr. Taylor. Hi, everybody. My name is Joe Sanchez, the Director of R&D Science Engagement at AstraZeneca. And I'm here to share with you some of the amazing resources that a company like AstraZeneca provides to STEM students, educators, and parents. Our flagship program, Generation Health, is a collaboration between Discovery Education, Learning Undefeated, and AstraZeneca. If you visit our program at howsciencepowersus.com, you can engage in a virtual field trip that transports you to our R&D laboratories. You can also download digital lesson bundles that focus in our disease therapeutic areas such as oncology, respiratory, cardiovascular, and metabolic disease. Another component of our Generation Health program, through our partner, Learning Undefeated, is the opportunity to mobilize STEM learning. Learning Undefeated transports mobile laboratories to schools so that students have the opportunity to engage with STEM in a hands-on environment. If you have the opportunity to engage in one of these mobile STEM labs, I recommend you do it. They're amazing. Through our Generation Health program and partnership, we were able to reach over 1 million students around the world. You might enjoy our award-winning Ask a Scientist YouTube video series, where we have AstraZeneca scientists, engineers, and clinicians give simple answers to the most complex questions. Please visit our YouTube channel at the address you see here on the screen. And if you want to know more about AstraZeneca, what we do as a company, and our commitment to STEM, I encourage you to visit our website at AstraZeneca.com, and especially our Generation Health program at HowSciencePowersUs.com. So I want you to have a great day, and I want you to remember what Dr. Taylor told you. Number one, STEM is awesome, or as we say, hashtag STEMazing. Number two, you can do it. Work hard, focus, and stick with it. And number three, we want you. We hope that you have such a great experience learning STEM that perhaps one day you'll want to contribute your talents to our industry and perhaps even our company.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor and Dr. Sanchez, for those inspiring words. And special thanks to AstraZeneca for being a valued partner of the XSTEM All Access program. Now, let's get started. I'm excited to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Kauf Juraza. Dr. Kauf is a psychiatrist and Duke University professor who leads the Laboratory for Psychiatric and Neuroengineering. In his lab, Dr. Kauf and his team try to uncover the changes in our brain circuits that can lead to psychiatric illnesses and develop ways to repair those circuits to help people suffering from mental illnesses. Dr. Kauf is doing important work and wants to show how STEM can help us learn all about mental health. Dr. Kauf, welcome to our program.
Thanks so much for having me. It's a real pleasure to be here with you all. You know, I was two years ago, joining you all with the Science and Engineering Festival, and so much in the world has changed since then. Like you all, many of us have been at home. We've been disconnected from friends. We've watched the challenges our country has faced, our family has faced, and perhaps you've been experiencing things like anxiety, or you've been finding it hard to motivate yourself. You haven't been spending time with grandma, or maybe some of you all have been home with younger brother or younger sister, helping them every day learn their new school materials. And I can only appreciate how difficult and how broad this challenge has been. I'm a psychiatrist, so I think a lot about feelings and when feelings change and the challenges that those might have. And I wanna tell you all now here as young folks that we care about you, we care about your well-being. If you're finding it a difficult time, you can talk to an adult, you can reach out to your school teachers. And even if you're at a place where you're worried about your well-being, there are numbers you can call, 1-800-273-TALK. As I mentioned, I'm a psychiatrist, and so I think a lot about how to help people who are struggling with their feelings. But I'm also an engineer and a brain scientist, so I think about where feelings come from. And what we do know is that feelings come out of an organ inside your head called the brain. And the brain is made up of all of these little cells. There are about 200 billion of them. And about half of those cells can generate little pulses of electricity. And the way I think about those little pulses of electricity that brain cells generate and how you get feelings is I think about each of those brain cells like a little key on a piano. Each one can play its own little tone or sound. And somehow the brain takes all of those keys on the piano and stitches them together into beautiful music. And that beautiful music becomes the underlying nature of the feelings and the experiences, the happiness, the sadness, and the anxiety that we experience. So as an engineer, I try to record electricity from brains. I use a model species, so I use little cute mice, and I try to record the electrical activity from many of those cells at the same time. And then I use a set of tools to decode that electricity into the beautiful music that makes up emotions. That set of tools is called machine learning or artificial intelligence. And what we're ultimately trying to do in my lab and as part of my research group is to come up with the electrical codes in the brains that make up feelings, so that we can diagnose mental illnesses and mental challenges the same way other fields of medicine do by creating objective measures, but also so we can come up with really cool and innovative treatments for those struggling with mental illness by changing the electrical music in the brain. We call those electrical patterns that make up feelings, we call them electomes. And then we try to come up with new tools, basically brain pacemakers, to change those feelings and electrical states in the brain. I told you about some of that work last time I was here with you 2 years ago and how it was coming along. I told you about the efforts our country was making to understand electrical patterns in the human brain and all of the potential that would come out of that to transform our daily lives and our daily experiences. And now I want to tell you about the role you can play in bringing about that future. You know, at the time, I had all these amazing questions from high school students in the audience about the tools and technologies that we were working to create. Some of those questions and challenges were, well, if you're extracting or if you're reading electricity from the brain to make sense of people's emotions, how can we still keep our emotions private, right? So these are questions around a framework that we call neuroethics. There are other types of questions that you could think about, right? And in the same way, we're looking at all the vaccines going out around the country. How can we make sure that everyone has access to these technologies? Certainly, if it is your brother or sister or your grandmother or your parents that are having challenges with mental illness, you want to make sure that they get the best technologies as well. All of this is framed around a space called neuroethics. And as some of the older folks, my colleagues and I were building out the outlay for this idea of coming up with these tools and technologies, one of the things we were really clear about was that we needed you all to weigh in on that technology being developed as well. We needed you all to think about these questions around neuroethics. What is the best way to keep your brain information safe and protected? How do we make sure that these tools are used for good and not problematic? And how do we make sure everyone has access to it as we develop? As we're thinking about this space called neuroethics, we launched what would ultimately be called the Brain Initiative Challenge for high school students out there. And that challenge went through, it ended last week. And it was just so remarkable to think about the ideas and the concepts, the problems that you all and your generation recognize, as well as the potential solutions around this area of what we call brain machine interface, developing these technologies to understand mental illness and to treat mental illness. And I always say, you know, looking forward on as new technologies come out, we shouldn't just trust the generation that brought you climate change. This is my colleagues and I and our parents to come up with the solutions, you all need to play a central and intimate role in coming up with those tools, the technologies, such that we can make sure that they are created in an ethical way and in an equitable way. So I'm really excited about the future. As I mentioned, I'm a psychiatrist, I'm an engineer, and I'm a brain scientist as well. And I spent most of my early time in life sitting behind a computer. And by the time I got to graduate school, I'd finally figured out how to take all the skills I'd learned as an engineer and making and writing programs and applying them to understanding the most complicated program that nature has ever created. And that is how our brains process information, how our brains process feelings, and how our brains create understanding such that we can move in the world and relate to each other. So I'm really excited about the future. I'm glad you all are here. I'm looking forward to taking your questions and hearing about your deepest thoughts about how to change and transform our daily lives and bring healing to all of our families, given the trouble and the challenges that we have faced as a species in the last year. So thanks so much for having me here. I'm excited.
Dr. Koff, that was fantastic, man. You spoke about neuroengineering, neuroethics, brain-computer interfaces, all stuff I personally nerd out about on a regular basis. So really excited to take a deep dive into these questions, and let's get started with that. Some of our audience members sent their questions before the show, and we have a few students who'll be asking their questions in person. So let's hear that first attendee question right now.
Let's do it.
Hello, Dr. Koff. I'm Amira from Washington, D.C. Since you were the first African-American to get a PhD in neurobiology from Duke University, how has diversity in your field increased?
Yeah, so thank you, Amira, so much for your question. I'm excited to see you here. I think the future of psychiatry and neuroscience and engineering is going to be in the hands of individuals like yourself, who will continue to take the best talent in our country and bring forth the best solutions and the best ideas for all of you all. The field has transformed tremendously since the time I came through. We can see this at a local level. I was the first African-American to graduate with a PhD in neurobiology at Duke. I was not the last. And even now in the department, there are four or five times as many in the number of African-Americans and those of Latinx individuals and other diverse backgrounds as well. I continue to be excited as the field not only gets more diverse in terms of racial ethnic backgrounds, but in terms of gender backgrounds as well, right? As I mentioned, the best solutions are going to come forth when we're tapping all of the talent in this country. So the field continues to evolve such that as the country's changing and becoming more diverse, that diversity is becoming represented in the field more broadly. So thanks so much for the question. Very important one.
That was an awesome perspective, Dr. Koff. Really appreciate that. And obviously, you know that diversity is a super important thing that we're all actively working on to improve the STEM workforce. We have another question written in here from Emily, who's in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. She says, I saw online that you met President Barack Obama. How did it feel to meet a president of the United States?
Yeah, shout out, Emily. How you doing down there in Florida? Hope things are sunny and wonderful. And thanks so much for your question. It was awesome. I actually had a chance to meet, I refer to him as 44. So I got to meet 44 in person three times. The first time I was invited to the White House to receive an award that is given to about 100 young scientists in the country every year. And what's so important about that award is it just doesn't look at those who are involved in doing good work at the computer or in the laboratory. It also identifies those that want to make our country better in terms of science. So those are involved in science leadership as well. So it was great getting to journey to the White House to receive this award. I can tell you, most of the folks there, the other young scientists and myself, we were hoping the First Lady, Michelle, would drop in and say hello. We didn't get a chance to meet her then. And then I got the chance to join 44 on the stage about 5 months later to really talk about brain science and how the work we're doing to enhance our understanding of the human brain would help cure and treat and change how we think about mental illness and the next generation of healthcare technologies. And then finally, I had the honor and the privilege of being with 44 again and 46 on the stage of the signing of a bill called 21st Century Cures. And that bill was really important because it provided some important funding for generating these new types of brain machine technologies, but it also put effort into understanding how our country can best support the next generation of scientists like yourself as you're coming through to bring about new cures and new treatments and new understandings in science and technology. So thanks so much, Evelyn. You have a great question.
Awesome. Yeah. And it's really cool because, you know, a lot of times one of the things we think about as well, Dr. Koff, is I've had the pleasure to meet 44 and 46 as well. And if we have scientists that choose to be in positions of policy informing, then we can have more informed politicians, more informed policies that are actually based on the real science. So that is a legitimate career path for someone that majors in a scientific discipline. So definitely something that you all should be considering as well. Looks like we have another question here from Mateo.
I will say scientists that understand policy have helped save our country in the last year. So I hope you all can understand the importance of scientists that can sit at the intersection of the two.
Yeah, thanks for adding that in there, Dr. Koff. And it looks like we have another question coming up as well from Mateo in California. Being a neuroscientist, psychiatrist, and engineer is an interesting combination. How did you decide what path you wanted to take? Where should I start if I want to join the field?
What's going on, Mateo? So shout out to the folks in California. Welcome. I just love learning. And the combination of loving learning and not being ready to get my first job meant that I just kept going and going and going. But I think for me, it makes a lot of sense, right? I want to understand this organ in the head called the brain. And what engineers do is they look at whole systems and figure out how whole systems work together. So it made a lot of sense for me in pulling together my understanding around engineering and brain science into a single framework. And when I ultimately realized what I wanted to do was figure out how to make people who were having illness in the organ of the brain function better, in other words, be more healthy, then it was important for me to understand what the illnesses look like and going into medical school as well. So what I always say to young people is figure out what you care about. Figure out whatever you're passionate about, what gets you out of bed, whatever big problem you want to solve, and then put all of yourself into it. You will figure out how to create the discipline that works for you. And that may exist between three or four different fields, but you'll find your way there. So I encourage you to on that path, Mateo. There's lots of videos online. I've done a lot, but there are other scientists across the field who have done a lot of speaking in this space as well. One that I'm really excited to hear from coming up. So I encourage you to check all those videos out and then just figure out what big problem you want to solve.
Awesome, Dr. Coffin. You definitely are right about that. You need passion for sure, because if you're sitting in an organic chemistry class, you're probably going to need passion to carry you through to the end of that semester. So looks like we have time for one final audience question. Dr. Koff, where do you see the future for mental health treatment?
Yeah, I talked a little bit about my talk when I was outlaying it as this idea of reading electrical signals in the brain. And I think we're going to be able to do that in the same way that if you start having chest pain and you go into an emergency room, they read electrical signals in your heart. So I think that's sort of the approach that we're going to take to understanding the brain. Now, where that's going to go in the long run is actually going to be more in your hands than in mine. I'm working on creating this technology, but you all are going to determine how that can be ethically used and how it can be used in an equitable way as well. And that's going to be critical for making our society and our world more healthy in the area of mental health. So I leave it in your hands, right? And I'm here to support and to provide a guide wherever I can be helpful. But I'm encouraged about you all and the future that you all will bring about.
Awesome, Dr. Koff. And that's right. You all are the next generation of innovators. You heard it here. Thank you to everyone else who submitted such amazing questions. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have today for questions. But Dr. Koff will be coming back a little bit later to answer some more questions. So don't go anywhere. If you have other questions for Dr. Koff that we didn't cover today, send them to us now using the form at usasciencefestival.org, and we'll get his questions to you after the program. Dr. Koff, it was an absolute pleasure meeting you, learning about your work, and hearing about the future of mental health. We'll see you again very shortly. Before we dive into our next speaker session, let's take a few minutes for a brain break.
Think like a scientist.
Ouch!
That blazer is very fresh.
trash.
Let me get my lab coat on. Okay, let's rap now.
Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Yeah. Processing your brain.
Let's get everybody trying
this. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist.
Yeah.
Rule that lab like a fierce science lion.
Observe, would
ask a question.
Hypothesize,
propose an answer.
Experiment,
test the question.
Analyze,
bam, look at the result.
Report,
there it is. Tell them what you learned.
Bring that lab heat, y'all.
It's Bunsen burned.
Wait, isn't that the scientific method?
Yeah, that's just another way of saying it.
Got it.
To observe, you ask a question and then start to theorize. Make an educated guess about the question in order to hypothesize. When you experiment, test the question, then analyze or study what happened. Finally, you can report the results, share it in writing, and then start rap now.
Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Put the process in your brain.
Let's get everybody trying
this. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist.
Yeah.
Rule that lab like a fierce science lioness.
All right, here's my experiment. What can I use to stop an egg from breaking when it's dropped?
I don't know.
Well,
observe. What's the question?
Could bread protect an egg if I drop
it? Hypothesize, make an educated guess.
I bet three slices would nicely stop
it. Experiment, try it out.
I had to drop a lot of eggs.
Analyze.
I can keep the egg safe with five slices of bread.
Report, share the data, don't keep it in your head.
Graphs, pictures, and writing earn you real scientist cred.
I'm a scientist.
Think like a scientist, put the process in your brain.
Let's get everybody trying
this. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Rule that lab, like a fierce scientist.
Observe, ask a question.
Hypothesize,
propose an answer.
Experiment,
test the question.
Analyze,
bam, look at the result.
Report,
there it is, tell them what you learned.
Yeah. Bring that lab heat, y'all.
Think
like a scientist, think like a scientist.
Yeah.
Processing your brain.
Ain't
everybody trying to think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Rule that lab like a fierce science lioness.
Yeah.
Think like a scientist, think like a scientist.
Put the process in your brain.
Ain't everybody trying to think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Rule that lab like a fierce science lioness.
Rule that lab.
Are you going to eat that?
Really just five raw eggs cracked on a loaf of bread.
I could put it in the microwave.
That's really gross, bro.
Beep boop.
Man, that was a fun brain break, wasn't it? I'm excited to welcome our very special next guest to our program. Dr. Francis Collins is the director of the National Institutes of Health, or the NIH. As the head of our nation's medical research agency and one of the top medical research centers in the world, he is dedicated to improving human health and saving lives in the process. And what you may not know about him is that Dr. Collins is a talented and passionate musician as well. Please welcome Dr. Francis Collins.
Hello, I'm Francis Collins, the director of the National Institutes of Health. And I'm jumping in to the middle of this session of the XSTEM virtual conference on exploring our minds. NIH, which I have the privilege of directing, is the nation's medical research agency and the world's largest funder of biomedical research. And many of you may also know it as the place where Dr. Fauci works, because he does. In fact, he reports to me. I could tell you a whole lot about what NIH is doing, but we don't have a lot of time for that. Let me just say, we share the conviction that first led Larry Bach to found the USA Science and Engineering Festival over a decade ago, that we have a great set of opportunities in science right now, and we want to capture the imaginations of students from all backgrounds if we want that dream to come true of fulfilling the potential of science to find answers to many, many problems in human medicine. And it was Larry's vision that if we celebrate science and engineering in the same way we celebrate movie stars and athletes, that more of you, will recognize that this is something you want to do. And boy, there are opportunities and we need your talent. So I'm glad you're part of this festival. In terms of the particular theme that we're in the middle of here, which is exploring our minds, I'm a geneticist. I had the privilege of leading the Human Genome Project. I'm a physician. I could not quite claim to be a neuroscientist, but I will tell you one thing that I've gotten involved in over the course of the last couple of years that has been really interesting, bringing together a different part of my human experience with science, because I'm also a musician and I really enjoy the opportunity to learn, to play music, to take part in musical events with other people, and just to listen to great music. And of course, how is it that music affects us? How can it be so powerful where it can lift our spirits or make us cry or give you chills? Well, that's because it interacts with the brain. Your brain has a music room where the sounds of music are actually processed in a slightly different way than what you are processing when you hear somebody speaking to you. And that tells you that this must be really important for human survival, or we wouldn't have a brain that's wired quite this way. So what have I been doing about that? Well, we've managed to bring together a whole group of people trying to investigate how music and the brain have things to say to each other. And my partner in this is none other than Renee Fleming, the famous opera soprano, who I met randomly 4 or 5 years ago at a dinner party. And we discovered we had that shared interest of how could we, by bringing together neuroscience and musicians and music therapists, really begin to understand how the brain processes music and how we could use that to help people with conditions like autism or PTSD or Alzheimer's disease or strokes. And that's turned into a really exciting NIH program called Sound Health. So I thought that might be a fun thing to mention to you in the middle of exploring our minds. And maybe rather than just talking about it, I thought it might also be fun to drop into the middle of your session here also a bit of an example of how music and the brain of the NIH director might work together. So I'm now going to insert right here something that I had my wife a video record, which is a song that maybe will fit today's theme. So hold on, here we go.
So yeah, your brain has a music room. And when music comes in there, sometimes it can lift your spirits, give you a dopamine rush. I don't know if I can do that for you, but let's try a little music here that maybe talks about the peaceful, easy feeling that music can bring to your soul. I like the way that music reaches my soul. Lifts me up when I'm down. In the dark of night, music opens up the sky. See a million stars all around. I got a peaceful, easy feeling. That music never lets me down. Had a sad day. Let your song play a joyful sound. A wondrous neural net, you've got that between your ears. True for every girl, every boy. So let the music rip, take a dopamine trip. Turn that sound into joy. I've got a peaceful, easy feeling. That music never lets me down. Had a sad day, let your song play a joyful sound. Had a sad day, let your song play a joyful sound.
So I hope you enjoyed that amateur production of something that represents something about the mind and how music can interact with it. And without further ado, let's go back to the main presentations where you can hear from a real neuroscientist about some really exciting things we're learning about that most complicated structure in the known universe, your brain. Thanks.
Wow. A very special thank you to Dr. Francis Collins for taking some time out of his very demanding schedule to join us today. If you're just tuning in, we are moving ahead with today's episode on exploring our minds. I hope you're ready to meet our second and final speaker for the day. Let's take another look into the amazing work inside a professional science laboratory. Our next speaker will tell you about her job and how it uses STEM to help us understand how our environment can affect how we feel. Dr. Kay Tai is a professor at the Salk Institute of Biological Studies in California, where she leads a systems neurobiology laboratory, also called the Tai Lab. She is interested in how emotions motivate specific behavioral responses and how our environment can trigger those responses. Professor Tai and her team look at the human brain circuits to see where those responses may go wrong and how we can better understand them, especially in the case of mental illness. Now, let's give a super warm welcome to Professor Kay Tai. What's going on? What's going on, Professor Tai? How you doing?
Hi, Justin. It's so great to be here. I'm delighted to tell you about the work that we do in my laboratory. So I'll tell you a little bit about who I am and how I got interested in science and my life outside of science, as well as how my life outside of science inspires the research program that my team works so hard to carry out. So given that what we've been through in the past year, it's been a dramatic, the largest social experiment on isolation that the humans have ever experienced. So this gives us a really interesting opportunity to explore this timely question. So today I'm just going to talk a little bit about who I am, because when I was younger, I didn't really understand what it was actually like to be a scientist, and I didn't necessarily know, what that would mean and what that would look like and who could be scientists. And then I'll talk a little bit about the research program and how things that have happened recently have really inspired this new direction of research in my laboratory. So first, I'm an older sister. This is my younger sister. Grew up in Ithaca, New York, where, it was a very different culture from where my parents came from. I really liked rock climbing. I was really into breakdancing and had a lot of other interests when I was in grad school. And science is just one of them. And I think this is important because, as I tell my kids, you can be more than one thing and just, you can be interested in lots of different things. And I think having lots of different interests enriches the way that we think, makes us more creative as scientists, and increases the diversity and the rich dialogue that we can have. Oops, sorry. So the project I want to tell you about today is the science of social isolation. One of the big questions is, what happens to your brain when you're socially isolated? What changes when you are isolated right away? And then over time, as you're isolated longer, what continues to change? This is July 4th, 2019, 2020. New Year's Eve, 2019, 2020. You get the idea, you lived it, you understand what I'm talking about. And social isolation, or even just perceived loneliness, correlates with the following: deficits in a number of mental and physical health disorders, a shortened lifespan. So specifically with mental health, increased anxiety and depression, and for physical health, increased morbidity and mortality for both cancer and heart disease, which, might not have been intuitively linked to social isolation. There's increased inflammation and increased symptom severity with viral immune challenge. So given all of these things, there's an urgent need to understand the neural circuit changes that underlie, the effects of perceived loneliness to prevent these negative effects. What is actually happening? If we don't understand what's happening, how can we prevent it? So this comes from an accidental study, an accidental discovery, of a neural substrate for a loneliness-like state. And so a trainee in my lab, Jillian Matthews, discovered that there are these dopamine neurons deep in the brainstem in a brain region that I will call the dorsal raphe nucleus. And after just 24 hours of social isolation, we see that the synapses coming on to these dorsal raphe nucleus neurons get stronger, and the neurons become more active when they are presented with a social target, in this case, another adult mouse, after being isolated. And so this just suggests that social isolation is being tracked by these dorsal raphe nucleus dopamine neurons. When we used a technique that both Dr. Koff and I use regularly in our laboratories called optogenetics, you can use genetically encodable light-sensitive proteins, put them into neurons, clone them into neurons, and then control the neurons. And if we activate these neurons, it makes animals more social, but it makes them not like it. They find the stimulation aversive. And so at first this was really confusing to us. How could something make you more social and be unpleasant? But you know, you can think about why you eat. You can eat for two reasons. One, because it's delicious, it's rewarding, it's enjoyable to eat this, you know, creme brulee after dinner or whatever. Or you can eat to escape the unpleasant state of being hungry. And maybe you eat something that's not super tasty just because it alleviates that unpleasant state of hunger. Similarly, we can engage in social interaction because it's fun to talk and it's rewarding and it feels good. Or we can engage in social interaction to escape the unpleasant state of being lonely. Along these lines, after animals, people, mice, monkeys are socially isolated and you reintroduce them to their social group, there's a big rebound in the amount of social interaction. This rebound of social interaction is blocked by silencing these neurons. And then finally, trying to think about how do we really get at a loneliness-like state in mice? Because loneliness is subjective, meaning that, you know, you can be in a crowded, you can be at a crowded party and feel lonely and left out, or you could be walking on a hike by yourself and not feel lonely. So how do we get at subjective experience in a mouse? It's hard, it's impossible. But one thing we could look at is the social rank. How do animals of different social rank perceive their environment? And so what we found is that optical manipulations we did to change the activity of these neurons were stronger in dominant animals. Maybe dominant animals enjoy their social environment more when they're isolated, they miss that, versus subordinate animals might feel relieved when they're isolated because their bullies are gone. So this is something that we're speculating, but based on this, we formed some new ideas. I do want to mention that we also found this to be true in humans, and we can isolate people for just 10 hours and find a way and find that this same brain region is activated. Now, the really tricky question is how do we maintain states in our brain and body? What is this word called homeostasis? Homeostasis comes from the Greek words for same and steady and refer to any process that living things use to maintain stable conditions for survival. So people, we are constantly maintaining certain body temperature, certain amount of blood glucose and energy level, certain amount of hydration, osmoregulation. And so within any homeostatic system, we need a couple of different components. We need, for example, let's use the example of thermoregulation. Let's say it's really hot outside and I'm getting overheated. Then detectors in my body will say, whoa, we're really hot. Compare that to a control center, which might compare that to our 98.6 degrees. And then if it's too hot, it'll say, okay, we need to do something about that and tell our effector system, maybe we need to move into the shade, maybe we start sweating, and then this will come back and shut off the thermostat. Now, imagine that we also have a homeostatic system for social contact. There's a certain amount of social contact that each individual prefers. Sometimes there's just too much social contact and you need some space and you need some alone time. Sometimes there's not enough and you feel lonely and left out. So one thing that we've been thinking about is why is it that after acute isolation and you're reintroduced to your social group, it's pro-social. You're super excited to be reintroduced to your social group. It's great. But then after chronic isolation, when you're reintroduced to your social group, it becomes antisocial. What's up with that? Because the social isolation is the same and the reintroduction to your social group is the same. The difference is the time. And so what's happening between this acute and chronic time point that changes the valence? And so the idea is that, okay, let's say that you have a deficit. We're socially isolated. Your effector system might be activated and put everything back to where it needs to be, or you might actually not be able to fix the problem in the case where social isolation is long lasting. Then at some point, you adapt to a new normal. This is what you're getting, and this is where you want to be. And eventually you adapt to a new normal. And then if you are now reintroduced to your social group at this late point, it can be perceived as overcrowding. And you feel antisocial, more territorial, more avoidant and aggressive than you might have otherwise. And so this is what we're trying to understand, the neural circuit mechanisms of this specific transition from pro-social to antisocial with acute and chronic isolation. Understanding this will help us figure out how to prevent the negative health consequences associated with social isolation. I want to thank everyone in my lab who's worked so hard to get the research done. I didn't have time to show most of it, but I hope that you check it out. I want to thank our funding sources, our collaborators, and all of you for showing up today and listening and being curious with your minds. So stay open, keep your minds open, be who you truly are in a complete whole fashion, and being the best complete version of yourself is what we need from our next generation, especially in STEM.
Awesome job, Professor Ty. Thank you so much for sharing your perspective, your backstory, what's going on over at Ty Lab, and also the science behind social isolation. I think that's a super pertinent topic, especially as we're now transitioning slowly but surely out of this pandemic. So it's time for a few questions from our audience. Thanks to everybody who submitted questions, and Professor Ty is going to answer a few of those coming up. If you have some more questions for Professor Ty, send them to us now using the form at usasciencefestival.org, and we'll get her answers to you after the program. Our first question is a video submitted by Andres from Maryland.
My name is Andres. My question for Dr. Ty is, how do mental illnesses affect the brain?
Hi, Andres. Thank you so much for your question. And, you know, this is a huge question. This is the question that researchers like myself and Kafoui Jarasa, who you just heard from, spend so much time thinking about. And I guess the short answer is it affects our brain in different ways depending on what the mental illness is. A lot of the circuits that we think that are important for mental illnesses lie within what I would call the cortical limbic system. So parts of our brain that are actually very evolutionarily conserved that we had for long time. The cloud that's made us better at planning and storing different concepts and being having larger social networks and being able to execute more tasks at the same time. But a lot of the circuits that we have that are important for processing emotion have been there for a very long time and are conserved across many species. And so this is one way that we can study them in animals. And fundamentally, I think the things that are perturbed, the neural circuits that are perturbed in mental health largely have to do with, in my opinion, valence processing, the assignment of what is good or bad. How does your brain decide to assign something as positive or negative, depending on what it is? This is really important. And if you can't accurately assess whether something is good or bad, you might have a number of different mental health disorders. And the other one is social deficits. At this point in our society, having a social impairment can be devastating for your quality of life, more so than many physical illnesses. And so this is something that we don't fully understand yet, but we are. And learning about circuits in the cortex and the amygdala and the brainstem all the way through how they play a role in modulating social behavior is something that's very important to understanding this hallmark feature of mental illness. Thanks, Andre.
That's such an interesting perspective. I mean, to think that pretty much all the animals, especially the mammals that we know of, have all this hardwiring and infrastructure to socialize within their brains, and ours might be like a slightly more advanced or even different version of that. Just really interesting to think about. Looks like we have another video question here from an audience member, Cecilia.
Hi, Professor Ty. My name is Cecilia, and I go to St. Louis School. Could you explain more about what the brain is made of?
Hi, Cecilia. Great question. What is the brain made of? I mean, if you were to open up a skull, because that's where brains are, and look at the brain, it's kind of this squishy, grayish, pinkish material. It's very soft. But what it actually is made of lots and lots of cells, some of which are neurons, some of which are glial cells. But cells in general are made of lipid bilayers, little fatty sacks of you know, cells that are capable of sending messages from one place to another. So neurons will receive messages from other neurons through a chemical signal, propagate that electrical signal down their axon, and send them to wherever they need to go. So the way I would think of the brain is a tangled mess of wires, of all these different signals being crossed up all over. And, you know, that's really held in place and made possible by neurons and other cells within the brain.
Man, the brain is such a fascinating and intricate and complex machine. Neurons are so cool. It looks like we have another video question coming in from one of our viewers right here.
Hi, Dr. Ty. I'm Jennifer. I was wondering, what have you found in your research about how children's brains have been impacted by quarantine related to the COVID-19 pandemic?
That is an excellent question. And so, you know, we haven't done longitudinal studies in human children or anything like that. We're working in animal models. I will say that social isolation can have more severe and long-lasting impacts when it happens on younger individuals. This has been shown in primate research as well as rodent research. The key thing is, how can we keep those social connections alive with social distancing? And there are many, many ways that our brain can perceive social contact, even if we are not physically close together. Having interactions virtually, it's not as good as being in person in real life, but it's almost as good. And it does a lot for our brain to feel connected. And hopefully you guys have realized that as well. And in terms of knowing what to do for, you know, children in the pandemic, I think trying to find alternative and creative ways to activate those circuits and keep them healthy and developing is really important. And so virtual, socially distanced, working your pod, all of those things are really great. Even reading books and using your imagination can activate a lot of the social circuitry and wiring in our brain. So I would say keep doing those things and you know, try to put your screen games down as possible.
Yeah, that's an interesting perspective, Kay. I mean, Professor Ty, rather. I've done a lot of virtual events and virtual classrooms and all kinds of virtual stuff, and it doesn't feel as good as in-person contact and working with folks, but it definitely seems to at least do something for me. So I'd have to agree with you there, at least anecdotally. So it looks like we have time for one more video question from our audience, and we'll hear that one now.
Hello, Dr. Ty. I'm Jillian. I'm a seventh grader. And I just wanted to ask you, what is your advice to girls who want to go into neuroscience or any other scientific field?
Hi, Jillian. It's great to hear from you. Thanks for your question. My advice would be to be yourself and follow your intuition. If you feel like you're really interested in something, just keep digging, keep being interested, follow the data, learn more, find mentors who support you and appreciate you. That can be women or men, just people who have insights and believe in you. I think surround yourself with people who support and believe in your curiosity, in your mind, in your potential, and your own curiosity. That thought that you're having in the shower, that thought that you're having before you go to bed, that is, you know, the questions you ask and wonder about of how this works or how come it's like this or why do I feel this way? These are the things that, you know, these are the trappings of a young scientist. So that would be my advice.
Thank you for that insight, Professor Ty. I think that's awesome advice. And you clearly are acting on that and being a role model for all of us. Thank you so much for everyone who submitted all these amazing questions. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have today for questions. But if you have another question for Professor Ty that we didn't cover today, send them to us using the form at usasciencefestival.org, and we'll get her to answer the questions after the program. Professor Ty, it was an absolute pleasure meeting you, learning about your story, and hearing all about the neuroscience of social isolation. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks so much, Justin.
Yeah, the pleasure is all ours. Please join me in giving Professor Ty a virtual high five, a round of applause, and all of the above. But Professor Ty isn't leaving us just yet. Let's welcome Dr. Koff back to the program.
Hello. Hey, what's going on, Dr.
Koff? Welcome back. And you are two neuroscience rock stars. And thank you for sharing all these fascinating perspectives on social distancing, depression, isolation. I think this work is super important and relevant, especially during a time when all of us are kind of isolated. And role models have been an important part of my own STEM journey. And I'm really curious about you all's role models. You know, as you started off in your careers, who did you all look up to in the pursuit of excellence in neuroscience?
Well, first, let me just say the last question. I was just smiling. Dr. Tai is one of the most inspiring neuroscientists that I know, one of my own heroes. And just hearing her words of encouragement for the next generation of young women scientists, it was just such a powerful thing for me to witness. I have been encouraged from a very young age, watching engineers of all backgrounds and all disciplines and all genders and all races. And it made me feel that there was a space for me in the field. And that's what allowed me to push through a lot of the arenas that I go into, where sometimes I'm the first and sometimes I'm the only. But I've always seen that there's space for me in those arenas and that I have something to contribute. So I just encourage all of you young people out there to just see yourself in these spaces and know that you have the power to change the future of our country and the world.
I was going to say the same about Koff, because Koff and I have known each other for a long time, and we sort of come up in neuroscience together, other opposite sides of the country, but, you know, studying the same research. It's really amazing to have that kind of community. And I have totally admire, worship Koff. Like, all my trainees are just, you know, it's definitely mutual admiration and respect. And it's been really cool to both grow up and also watch, you know, Koff's career unfold. And I think one of the beautiful things about academia and science is that you get to make friends from all over the world that are all different types of people. And those friendships last decades and decades. And, you know, we might never live in the same city, but I know I will see Koff, you know, from time to time, and always get to catch up. And I think having that support system and viewing it as a support system is super important.
Awesome. Yeah, and I know that academic camaraderie is super important, especially when you're going through these high-level graduate classes and doctoral programs. That can be the make or break reason that you end up sticking around. So that's a great
perspective. Yeah, but I'll say to the young folks out there, it's not just the academic setting. In this last year, some of the most sustaining experiences we've had is connecting with each other as human beings and as friends as we're navigating a pandemic. And so I encourage everyone, as you're going in this, it's not just about the next task. It is about those important human relationships that we have that sustain and nurture each other.
Absolutely. And thanks for sharing that insight. It looks like a lot of audience members that we had sent in questions about your scientific discoveries. Can you tell us about which one of your discoveries is the most exciting or is your favorite? Why don't we start with you, Professor Tai?
Well, I would like first to start with the scientific discovery that Koff made that I thought was most exciting. And it was this idea of an electome, that you can identify differences within different brains that, you know, to get better at breaking through that black box of diagnosis. It's not just the behaviors, because many different things that you know, circuit perturbations could lead to similar looking behaviors. And especially with the way that we diagnose mental health disorders now, with wide ranges of too much or too little sleep, too much eating or too little eating, you know, any of these disturbances, that's a very wide range of ways to classify disease states. And Koff was really getting at the electrome, the specific electrical signatures. And the stuff that we've worked on that I'm most excited about is looking at neural representations of social rank and also how you represent social contact and if it's enough. So those are the discoveries that I'm sort of most interested in right now. Like, how do we know our place in a social hierarchy? And when something changes in the world around us or within our social group, how do we know what we're supposed to do next? If the leader is gone for whatever reason, how do we decide who the next leader should be? And I think this type of social structure is seen all throughout our daily lives. So yeah. Hope I didn't butcher that.
Yeah, it's funny. I think we're both like super fans. So I was actually going to talk about the first time I heard Professor Tai give a scientific talk at a meeting. It's called American Clinical Neuropsychopharmacology, ACNP, the American College of Neuropsychopharmacology. And I remember the talk she gave. She was talking about how when a brain is stressed, how its ability to process rewarding experiences and motivating experiences totally changed. And it was one of the things that has really inspired me to dig in deep into this space of understanding depression and how the brain changes in the context of depression. The study that she mentioned that we did, we weren't just interested in that case of what happens when you have depression. We wanted to ask the question, why is it that some people, when they're stressed, they end up being depressed, and other people, when they're stressed, they end up showing what's resilience. In other words, the stress makes them function in a way that's even more optimal. And so we were essentially looking in the brain to see if we could figure out what that signature was of future risk. In the same way that if you're a cardiologist, you might measure blood pressure or heart rate as a measure of future risk, we were trying to look for an electrical pattern in the brain that mirrored future risk. And so we've been really excited about that work and the hope that ultimately we can help people be more resilient to the stressful experiences they enter into.
Dr. Call, that's fascinating. And I mean, wow, because I mean, I think about that because I think I'm one of those weird people that when I get really stressed out, like that's when I'm at the optimal performance. And so I'd really be interested in some of the implications of that research as it continues to roll out in the future. Super interesting perspectives there. And I think this one actually goes to your earlier point, Dr. Koff, about how it's important to have relationships in academia and work, but also personal ones that are real and authentic. And let's just ask this question for fun. Outside of academia, what is y'all's favorite hobby? Let's start with you, Dr. Koff.
So I always laugh at this one. Because it's a funny one. So I love watching cage fighting. So I'm a huge UFC fan. Right?
Me too.
And I go to UFC fans. I've got my outfit on. Funny enough, I won an award last year. I bought myself a replica UFC championship belt because it felt like going through a fight to win that award. So yeah, my pastime is literally watching other human beings with the utmost respect and dignity beat up on each other.
That's super cool. What about you, Professor Todd?
That's so funny. I don't watch UFC. I do some Taekwondo with my kids, though. I just started doing that, but mostly surfing these days. I mean, I used to break dance a lot, which is sort of like dance fighting. I don't know. It's something. And then
Can you do a really cool breakdance move?
My windmills are probably better than my head spins, but I can headspin, you know. But yeah, I used to battle a lot, and now I'm, you know, the nightlife is not conducive to my family life, so now I surf in the mornings.
Well, that's awesome, man. And that goes to show, I mean, look how it doesn't matter what you end up doing in academia, you can always have the most diverse interests. Who would have thought we'd meet a neuroscientist that could do a head spin today? That is pretty cool. Professor Ty and Dr. Koff, it's been an absolute pleasure getting to know you all a little bit better, learning about your fantastic research. Thank you so much for sharing your stories with us, and I hope to cross paths with you all in real life someday, maybe go surfing or catch one of those MMA fights.
Looking forward to it. Can't wait.
All right. Awesome. So I hope this program has inspired you all to dream big, and let's keep the momentum going and take the next step by visiting usasciencefestival.org/next-steps for free STEM resources from today's speakers, our partners, and more. Here, you'll find a list of free resources for students to help guide and enhance your own STEM journey. Check it out. And for the educators in the audience, you'll also find materials you can use in the classroom as well. I'd like to again thank our generous partners at AstraZeneca, the U.S. Air Force, and the U.S. Department of Defense, DoD STEM, for supporting this XSTEM All Access program. I hope you've enjoyed today's second episode of this XSTEM All Access series. Don't forget to tune in at the same time tomorrow for High Altitude Inspiration featuring aviators Major Jay Park and Captain Barrington Irving. If you missed any of the sessions, the entire series will be available on demand at no cost. Visit usasciencefestival.org for more. Mark your calendars for these upcoming programs for the USA Science and Engineering Festival. Get ready for another XSTEM All Access in September. Educators, join us in May and November for the Inspire Educators Workshop Series, hosted by world champion magician and host of Impossible Science at Home, Jason Latimer. And don't miss the SciFest Virtual Expo in October. Visit usasciencefestival.org for more information. And don't forget to show us how you STEM. Tag at USA Science Fest and me at Mr. Fascinate and use the hashtag show us how you STEM and XSTEM. Thank you for joining us from around the globe. Each and every one of us has the ability to change the world, and STEM can be a part of how we do that. We can't wait to see what the future holds for all of you and the next generation of innovators. See you tomorrow.